All right, folks, I guess we'll get started. Welcome, thanks for coming today. I'm Scott Heck, I'm the director of Sharon Audubon, and it's a pleasure to have Todd with us today to talk about some golden eagles. Before we get started, there's some housekeeping. There are restrooms through the back, through the hallway to the left, and emergency exits, of course, either side of the room. So if you need to exit fast, that's where you go. We first got to know Todd through an individual golden eagle that was brought to Sharon Audubon Center being injured, found by some folks in Armenia, brought it to us. We took care of it initially, and then it was transferred over to Tufts Veterinary Center, which is where Todd found out about the eagle. And Todd has been doing research on golden eagles. And subsequently, the eagle was fitted with a transmitter, and we released it up on Mohawk State Forest. And there were some folks there, witnessed the release. Some folks were there. It was one of the coldest days of the year. The wind was blowing like crazy, and we had a big crowd there. It was a lot of interest, and everyone was really excited that the eagle just took off and flew perfectly, and it was very spectacular day. And what has been equally spectacular is that we've been able to track its movements through this transmitter that Todd's going to talk about, a very special type of technology. So it's been fun to see where it's been going over the past couple of years, and learning more about its movements, and Todd's going to explain the importance of that. Can't read the Russian side of his card. I guess he works and does some work in Russia too. I can't really read that. But Todd is a research assistant professor at the West Virginia University, and it's a pleasure for us to have him here today.
Thanks very much for the introduction, Scott. Thanks to all of you for showing up. It's nice that you know where the emergency exits are. If I say something wrong, you'll know where to go. What I'm going to do, I'm going to turn off these lights. We opened up the windows in the back of the screen, so hopefully this is an okay light level for you folks. It'll be a little easier to see some of the images. What I'm going to do is tell you a bit about my research on golden eagles, primarily in Eastern North America. I've actually been doing work with goldens recently in California. We got a big project associated with wind energy, and I've actually done a fair bit of work with eagles in general, including golden eagles in Central Asia. My target is half in Russian because I work in Kazakhstan. I go there at least once a year, sometimes two or three times. There's a lot of interest in eagles right now, primarily because there's a place in California called Altamont Pass where there are wind turbines, thousands, hundreds, maybe thousands of wind turbines. And Altamont kills over 1,000 birds of prey every year, of which an average of around 65 or 70 are golden eagles in a year. And golden eagles are large, they're long-lived, they're large, which means they're visible, people care about them, they're charismatic, they're long-lived, which means if you kill one, you're having a bigger demographic impact than if you kill one sparrow. Because there are many sparrows, they reproduce quickly, they die with frequency. Golden eagles don't die with the same frequency, so if you increase the rate at which they're dying, you're impacting their population. So we, about 6 years ago, gosh, seven, it's been a while, we started a program to focus on golden eagles in Eastern North America. And we started off tracking these birds with conventional satellite telemetry, a little transmitter that you put on the bird's back. It's got a GPS on it. It collects data, and about two or three times a week, it sends packet of GPS data, so 50 GPS locations or something like that. We got a lot of information from those units, but they weren't really telling us what we wanted to know. So to
together with a couple of colleagues, I started a company, and I do the biology side, the colleagues do the technology side. I started a company to make a different kind of transmitter. These transmitters are GSM transmitters, so they function by sending data over the mobile phone network. We can get a lot more data out of these units. We can collect data at 15-minute intervals instead of one-hour intervals, the way the satellite telemetry units work. And then sometimes we can collect data at 30-second intervals. So we can get an incredible amount of information on these birds, which really tells us all kinds of things about their movements. And if you think about an eagle, golden eagle, bald eagle, moving down the ridge line, if you get one data point every hour, you're going to generally be able to understand where that bird went, what it did, what flight altitude it was at. But we're collecting data in some places at 30-second intervals. So we know exactly when that bird gets a lift from the air, when it comes down. We're able to understand that in really intimate detail. And so we're able to understand a lot more about potential risk that that bird faces. So all of that is sort of background to the research that we're doing on movement of golden eagles. I'm going to start out by telling you a little bit about golden eagles in general, giving you a broad picture of golden eagles in the East, and then I'll go into a little bit about some of the different projects that, or some of the different sort of components of the study that we're actually looking at. So, golden eagles in eastern North America are the sort of subspecies that ranges throughout North America. Canadensis is their subspecific name, the genus is Aquila, the specific name is Chrysaetos. It's a small population, we don't really know how big it is. I think it's probably somewhere around 2,000 individuals. Some people think it's substantially bigger, maybe 4,000 or 5,000. Some people think it's 1,000. At the end of the day, it doesn't matter, it's a small population. There's a couple hundred breeding pairs, primarily in Quebec, maybe a few in Labrador, a few in Ontario. They are geographically distinct. These birds from the east tend to migrate to the central Appalachians and go back north. And we thought that there was really not a lot of mixing with birds from further west. Some recent telemetry data is suggesting that there is some mixing. I'll talk a little bit about that. They're migratory, as I first mentioned. They were first recognized early in the 1930s by a guy named Maurice Bruin, who was the first curator of birds in Hawk Mountain Sanctuary. He was the first guy to count migrating birds there. And Hawk Mountain is a great place. If you haven't been there, it's worth a visit. Lots of birds migrate through there. And he was really the first person to count these birds. And he was seeing golden eagles, and everybody said there were golden eagles. And so he actually had to bring the colonies out at that time, put them on the hill with them and say, look, here's golden eagle. And then that was when he convinced people that there were golden eagles. Golden eagles don't breed in eastern North America right now. At least there are no known breeding pairs. There was confirmed breeding into the late 1990s in the state of Maine. These birds were extirpated primarily because of DDT. I think they last produced viable offspring in the early 80s, when they were just trying to reproduce and failing because of DDT poisoning. There are birds exploring territories in Maine, historically occupied territories, so there's a chance that in the next couple of years we could have breeding golden eagles in Maine or in other places. These birds face a couple of conservation concerns. Wind energy is one of them. There are other threats as well. I'll talk about them. This is a range map. Gives you some idea of a big scale overview of where these birds live, breed, migrate in winter. This is sort of the breeding range, way up in northern Quebec, a little bit of Labrador, a little bit of Ontario. They're also breeding eagles down in the Gaspé Peninsula in southern Quebec. All of these eagles migrate down into the central Appalachians. Actually, one bird that was telemetered stayed in the Gaspé 2 winters ago, and it migrated. So, you know, they can stay potentially in the southern parts of their range. We do get birds wintering up in northern Maine, and we get them wintering all the way down in Alabama.
between West Virginia, Pennsylvania seems to be sort of the hot spots for winter birds. We are right about here. If I were to make this range map today, I would just skirt, I would cut the corner of, I would include the corner of Connecticut and Massachusetts in there, because as I'll show you today, you have golden eagles right here wintering, although probably not in quite as high numbers as we do in West Virginia and Pennsylvania. But this sort of gives you an overview. Every year at Hawk Ridge, right on the Lake Superior, they get somewhere 150, 200 golden eagles migrating through there. So they get, there's a little few birds that go down here in winter in this, what's called the driftless area of the Mississippi. Sometimes they get further south. But this gives you generally an idea of the range of these birds. In the breeding season, these guys breed on cliffs, occasionally on trees. They eat hare, rabbits, hares, galliforms, which are things like spruce grouse, ptarmigan, stuff like that, and corvids, crows, and ravens. There's the possibility that these guys eat an awful lot of birds, more birds than you would expect of other golden eagles. I think that's a bit unsubstantiated. There are records from the 30s saying they eat birds, and so people say that, oh, these eastern eagles eat birds all the time. We need a lot more information on the breeding ecology of these birds. But they have somewhat big home ranges in the breeding season, 500 to 2,000 square meters. That's pretty typical. It's on the large side for a golden eagle. In the winter, they winter throughout the Appalachians, primarily in that central part, but they also get over the coastal plain of Maryland and Delaware, I think in South Carolina. But the highest density is right in the central Appalachians. They eat a lot of deer. I have sort of a working hypothesis that golden eagle populations are actually have been increasing over the past 20 or 30 years because there's so much winter kill deer. We have really high deer populations in a lot of this region. And that gives them a lot of food, a lot of stuff to eat. Their home range in winter is variable, but they're primarily in forested habitats, as Laura and I were talking about yesterday. If you have a golden eagle in the middle of the forest, even in winter when there aren't a lot of leaves on these trees, you can't see real far in those forests. There could be 100 golden eagles out there, and you might not see any if you're going on a walk through the forest. They're going to go away from you. So they're tough to find, tough to see, but they are out there. They migrate. This is an image showing southbound migration of golden eagle up on Ngaba Bay in Quebec through Labrador, and it's going to shoot all the way down into, I think, West Virginia. Migration is primarily from mid-October to mid-December. You get a lot of birds in Pennsylvania, somewhere in November usually. They started probably in early October, way up there. There may be what we call leapfrog migration, where some of these birds from the Gaspé winter in upstate New York come back, please. It'll come back, I think. Maybe not. Some of these birds from the Gaspé, which was right about here, winter in upstate New York, whereas these birds from Quebec are not for in spring, they migrate from late March to early April, probably a little bit earlier. You do get birds moving in February, especially some of these breeding adults that want to get further north. Most of this migration is through the central Appalachians. As you go further east to Hawk Mountain and then even to the Jersey Shore, like Cape May, you get some of the younger birds that really don't have much of a clue of what they're doing, and they sort of get blown off course. But there's not a lot known about connectivity in these populations, which birds go where, and how they get there. We've delivered about 50 birds now, so we are beginning to build a pretty good database on some of this, but there aren't any really good patterns developing. So in terms of the population trends, there is a long-term decline in population size of eastern golden eagles, but this is due to a whole suite of things, some of which I can talk about, but there has been an apparent recovery since the end of the DDT era. And we've got, obviously, many birds wintering in the central Appalachians as far east as we are right here. So if you look at trends from hawk count data, th-
This is Hawk Mountain, Pennsylvania, Tadoussac, which is way up on the St. Lawrence in Quebec, Wagner's Gap in Pennsylvania, Holiday Beach, Hawk Ridge. You can see the number of birds being counted at these hawk watch sites is increasing, which is nice. You know, we don't know if this means the population is increasing, but we think it probably does mean that. These counts are adjusted. One of the things we've seen is that in the 70s, people at Hawk Mountain shut down their count in mid to late November because the broadwings were done migrating. There's no reason to count after the broadwings were there. But actually, when they started staying later, they started seeing a lot of late red tails and golden eagles showing up. And so they started extending their counts a little later than they getting more golden eagles. These images, counts are adjusted for that seasonal window, but regardless, you can still see there seems to be an increase, which is probably a positive sign. That increase is through about 2004. Since then, it seems to have leveled off at most count sites. There are a couple of really neat things about this population. I like this slide because it lets me talk about those neat things. In black, up here, in the upper part of the slide, are the last year in which there was no inbreeding in each of the states in northern New England and New York. So in Vermont, the last known breeding was in 73. In Massachusetts, the last known breeding was in about the 1880s. New Hampshire, last known breeding was 1962. And then in parentheses, we've got 1955. That was the last time that viable offspring were produced, that offspring fledged. So again, you can see there's a 7-year lag, probably a DBT issue. At least they were not letting internal eggs. New York, 1970 was the last time that they had viable offspring. They hung on until 1995. Now, these birds were trying, but there was just too many poisons in the environment. Maine, same thing, 97 and 84. So this gives you some idea of the recent history of these birds in the area. Down here in red, we've got the other side of the story. And this is sort of a story of good intentions gone bad. People have decided, especially in the southern Appalachians, that they see golden eagles in winter, so they must have been breeding there. And so the way to fix the problem, because this must be a problem if you're not seeing golden eagles breeding, is to capture eagles from the west, breed them, and throw the young out there. And this is what is known in conservation biology as exotic introduction. These are non-native birds that are being thrown into environment where there is no context for them. There is prey, there is a suitable habitat, and one of two things happens. You can either get a population established and doing weird things, think about starlings and house sparrows and pigeons, none of which are native to this continent, but they're everywhere, or you can get a lot of dead animals. The third option, which actually seems to be what's happening, is most of the animals die, and then one or two pairs sort of hang on for a while and try and produce young. So two weeks ago, a hatchier golden eagle showed up in Tennessee, starving basically, and it's now in a rehab center, and this bird is almost certainly going to be released with a tracking device, at which point it's going to live for a month or two and probably die, and then we'll find out why it died because it has a tracking unit on it. But the most likely reason it's going to die is because it's going to starve because there's not a lot of food for golden eagles in Tennessee in the summer. So in any case, these are the stories of these historic introductions. There have been about 200 birds dropped into the southern Appalachians over the past 30 years or so. Since about 1983, 1984, Tennessee stopped doing introductions in the mid-2000s after spewing out about 47 birds, only one or two of which survived. The other consequence of this, of course, is that if there was any genetic differentiation between eastern golden eagles and western golden eagles, that genetic differentiation would likely be eliminated by introduction of 200 birds, which could be as much as 10% of the population overall. So I'm not a big fan of introductions like this, obviously, but it is part of the history of what's happened with these birds. So many people are unaware that golden eagles in the East exist, that it's changing slowly. State recognition is variable. State wildlife action plans always focus on breeding species.
Right.
But we actually have these birds that come in winter here. And so eastern golden eagles only occur in 5 of 23 state wildlife action plans, which isn't that unusual, but you know, something hopefully will be changed in the coming years. In terms of legal and regulatory protection, 6 of these 23 states protect them. At the federal level, you've got the Golden Eagle Protection Act and the Migratory Bird Treaty Act protecting them. 2009, there's a new federal rule that's allowing non-purposeful take of eagles. The goal of this is to allow wind power development, because right now, or previous to this rule, if you killed an eagle and you don't have a take permit, then you would be liable, you have broken the law. This way, you can give somebody a take permit for non-purposeful take, so that if they accidentally kill an eagle at a wind farm, then they're not going to be prosecuted. As it stands, actually, you know, they've killed 1,000 golden eagles at Altamont, and there's never been a prosecution of it. So I'm not sure. I mean, this is nice that it can allow things like that, especially for things like bald eagles, which are incredibly common and not going to be impacted right now. At a population level, but in reality, this just isn't having that much of an impact. These birds face a whole series of threats. One of the biggest is leghole traps and snares, incidental trapping that is being done for bobcat, coyote, foxes, skunk, things like that. And golden eagles have a tendency to land on the ground and walk down trails in the forest, and I'm not sure why, but they do it. This is the leg of a golden eagle that I was involved in rehabbing. This was a male golden eagle that was captured in a leghole trap in West Virginia. The trapper did the right thing. He brought it to West Virginia DNR. DNR gave it to us. I was in the zoo at the time. The vet at the zoo said she had a rehab permit. It turned out she didn't. But we rehabbed it at the aviary, but you can see that's bone right there, and that's muscle around it and tissue. And we worked on this bird. I caught this bird up every day for about 8 to 12 weeks, because what was happening was it was you give it quail, stick some antibiotics in there to beat the antibiotics to the infections. And it would pick the antibiotics out and eat the rest of the because they tasted that. And so we would take mice and cover a hole in the dead mouse, stick an antibiotic and tablet in there, and then close it up. And the vet would do that. And then I would catch it up and hold it. And then one of the husbandry staff would force feed it the mouse. And then they'd do it quail. And that way, the bird survived, managed the infection. And this bird, actually, we put a transmitter on it. It was one of our best birds. It lasted for 5 years until it was killed in a leghole trap in Quebec. And so this is sort of the threats these guys face. Lead poisoning is a big one. If you hunt, you better use copper bullets, both for your health and for wildlife. You shoot a deer with a lead bullet fragments, and you take out the guts, leave them in the woods, they get eaten by mammals and birds. But almost invariably lead fragments in that gut pile. And then that will poison birds. Birds are much more sensitive than mammals to lead poisoning, and so it has a lot of consequences. Turns out the Peregrine Fund and a few other organizations have done studies where they have shot deer and sheep and things like that, and then x-rayed the carcasses, and you can get lead fragments up to 18 inches from the exit hole on a deer. Yeah. And so if you've ever butchered a deer and you get rid of the hematoma and stuff like that, there's still lead in that carcass. And so I always encourage hunters to use copper bullets. Collision is a threat. DDT, DDE, poison. Incidental poisoning, people put out poison bait for coyotes and things like that. People can get
There are also a series of indirect threats, habitat loss, habitat change from energy development, climate change. All of these things are impacting golden eagles. So before I get into the research, that's sort of a big overview. Before I get into the research, I wanted to talk a little bit about this bird that you folks helped to rehab. We are obviously right down around there. And this is the migration track from this bird. It was captured in winter 2010-2011. I'm going to have to rearrange that key because I can't follow it. Winter 2010-11 is the blue, and then spring 2011 is the green. This is how it went up, and then it had a breeding territory up here in eastern Quebec, right above Labrador, and then fall 2011 it migrated down this way and came right back to the same area that it was, this area of New York, Connecticut, Massachusetts, and then this past spring, 2012, the dark blue line went up there. This is fairly typical for an eagle migration. This is the winter movements of the bird over 2 years. I think that a lot of people, including myself, were surprised that it spent a lot of time in Massachusetts and Connecticut over these 2 years. And not only, you know, we released it somewhere right around here, I guess, and you know, you would expect if we released it there, it's going to be in Connecticut, right? But it went over to New York and then came back and then went up. But then when it returned the following year, it came back right to the same area and went back and forth, just like it was the year before. I flew over to this area yesterday when I came in from Pittsburgh. And I was really, I mean, I guess I've known this, but I was reminded strongly, this is a really forested, not heavily roaded area of the state. And that's the kind of habitat that golden eagles like. So you've got one bird, you've almost certainly got others entering here. And I was actually talking with Lori about setting up a bait station for golden eagles in the winter. And I'll talk more about our bait station program. But it would be really easy to see if we get an idea of how many are out here, because there's almost certainly more than one. Anyway, that was the winter movement. This is spring migration. Started out down here, popped up across St. Lawrence, and then I can go up and forth. Spring tends to be a little bit faster migration than fall. If you think about it, that bird, there's all kinds of other birds, all the golden eagles are migrating. And if you're slow, somebody else might steal your territory. So it's really important that you get back up to your territory as early as possible. What you want to do is get there just as there's enough prey, because you know the prey are coming out of hibernation in terms of ground squirrels, they're going to be more visible if they're hares. You want to get there when there's enough food for you to survive, but you need to time it so that you're before everybody else, but not so early that there's no food for you. You've got to balance that just right. So there's this race to get north. And we have actually seen some birds go up, come back, and then go up again, which is consistent with sort of, I'm trying to get up, and then there's no food, so I come back to get some food, and then I try again. So that was the spring movement. This was the home range of the bird. Probably has a nest here, maybe over there. I think it's probably right around there somewhere. And these are the movements throughout the whole season. You can see a scale 10 miles, so that's a pretty big area. But this is what a golden eagle home range looks like. There's what we call central place foragers. And central place, and they go out and forage in all different directions from there. So, and then this was the southbound migration, starting up there October 11th or so. But yeah, and you can see it's a little bit slower. She's taking her time, she's kind of hanging out. She knows where she's going. She's done this a lot before. This is a full adult bird. And, if this was a juvenile, you'd expect sort of wandering like this, back and forth, generally going south. But she knows what she's doing, and she's going to end up right back where she was. Like I said, she's taking her time. This is, it's now
that's Thanksgiving Day, and she's still in Quebec. So this was basically a two-month migration. The northbound migration in spring was, I think, about a 3 or 4 week migration at that time. So you can see she ended up down there, right where we are. So yeah, this is that whole map again. Gives you some idea of the context and the movements of that bird. We will keep tracking it. Hopefully, there's not a lot of cell phone towers north of here, so she won't send data all summer. And then, assuming she survives, and assuming the transmitter hasn't cracked out, when she gets somewhere down here in the fall, in a couple of months, she will dump the summer's worth of data, and we'll see what she did, where she went. So, and that's due to you folks. So, yeah. And in fact, I can give you a copy of this map.
That'd be great.
We might put it down to the logo or something like that. But anyway, so research on these birds. We're doing telemetry and statistical and spatial modeling to understand the global response to habitat, to weather, to topography, and then to understand the risk and response to turbines. And ultimately, what we want to do is generate maps, predictive maps, of the entire region that said bad place for turbines. Good place for eagles. Good place for turbines, because eagles never go there. And we're using these two types of telemetry units that I talked about, these hourly data points as well as the high frequency ones. That we pretty much dumped the hourly ones because they really don't tell us that much. Most of what I'm going to talk about today is just data analysis from telemetry. We're just doing this movement modeling and risk analysis right now. That's underway. So this actually isn't an old table, but I might picture it, and it's an added one. Bird in flight. It's an imperial eagle, actually, from Kazakhstan. But it looks a bit like a golden eagle, and most people don't know unless I say something. So the first part that I'm going to talk about is flight altitude of these birds, right? If you think about it, how high a bird is flying is an important component of the risk they're going to face, because if they're flying more than 200 meters in the air, they're above the height of a turbine and can't get hit by a turbine blade. So we measured several parameters related to altitude above ground level, that's AGL. We looked at the response to the landform over which the birds were flying. So we said, if it's a flat area, are they high or low? If it's a ridge, are they high or low on average? We also looked at the type of movement, right? If they're long, in a given time, are they moving long distances or short distances? If they're moving long distances, do they fly high or low? If they're moving short distances, do they fly high or low? Then we looked at distance from wind resources that energy developers prefer. So energy, wind turbines don't go anywhere. They're not randomly distributed. They're put in places where there's good wind. We wanted to understand whether eagles like those places with good wind or they go to other places. For this project, we used satellite telemetry. This is a data point every hour. It was just useful in this particular case. So the first thing we can say is that there really is a response to the landform over which birds are flying. If they're over summits and cliffs, really steep slopes, they're flying lower to the ground. If they're over gentler slopes and gentle hills and flat areas, they're much higher. So the first question you ask is why? Well, think about what an eagle is, how it flies, things like that. Eagles are not hummingbirds. Hummingbirds flap a lot, right? When you weigh 6 kilos, you can't flap a lot. You don't have the muscle mass to do that. So what you've got to do is look for ways to soar and fly, what we call subsidize the lift that these birds use. So they're fixing their wings and they're just flying. There's basically two types of subsidized lift that you can get on terrestrial systems in a place like this. One is something called deflected or orographic lift. So you've got a ridge line, wind comes in, hits that ridge, bounces up. That generates lift for the bird. Orographic lift is generally less than 200 meters above the ground. So above the top of these cliffs. So the wind comes and it hits the cliff, bounces up about 200 meters, and then gets pushed away. right? So they're using, over really steep areas, they're using that orographic lift, which is why they're low. The other type of lift that you can use is generated over more gentle terrain. That's thermal lift. So if you think about thermals, you see turkey vultures riding on the slopes around the hill, or excuse me, next to a road or something. You've got a bare area next to a road, and there's a lot of heat coming off it. The heat rises, generates thermals. Thermals can get up really high. You can get 1,000 meters in the air, 2,000 meters in the air. The flight record for a bird, anybody know this? This is a really cool trick. Flight record for a bird is something like 33,000 feet, and the way that they got this record was that I believe it was a DC-10 over Africa hit a Rapel's griffin vulture and lost an engine. The airplane was fine. I mean, the airplane landed. It survived. The bird did not survive, but they were able to pull the bird out of the engine, and they said, wow, this was a bird at 33,000 feet. And what almost certainly happened is that bird caught a heck of a thermal and just got lifted up and kept going and kept going. And you think about it, there's all kinds of cool things. Like, there's not a lot of air in there. You know? But in any case, thermals generate, big thermals get generated over flatter areas where there's a lot of surface and for lift to generate. So that's why you're seeing this. But what you're seeing is a response to altitude, but a response in the bird's flight to the topography they're over, which impacts risk. The other thing that we looked at, we divided movements. The first slide, this was all movements of birds, all day airplanes. We divided these up into times when birds were moving less than 5 kilometers, so we called those local movements, and 5 kilometers per hour, or greater than 10 kilometers per hour. And we call those migratory movements. If you're moving more than 10 kilometers per hour, you're hauling. You're going somewhere quickly. If you're moving less than 5 kilometers per hour, you're probably not going somewhere quickly. And lo and behold, in local movements like these, the birds tend to have much lower flight altitudes. They're probably using flapping flight, maybe a little bit of orographic lift, but they're staying close to the ground. When they're making migratory movements, they're getting much higher up in the air. If you think about it, if you want, the way people count birds in the east primarily is with hawk counts, right? You go out and you do a hawk count, and so when they evaluate wind sight, they'll always put somebody out there doing migration to do migration counts. You're missing this entire section of local movements when you're doing that. And if you're missing those, you're not really understanding risk completely. I don't have a good answer to how to fix that. Yeah, but this is something to consider in risk analysis for eagle sites. And then what we did is we looked at the way eagles flew in relation to what wind developers call good winds. And they have a scale of 1 to 7 to describe wind energy or potential wind power. And anything better than 3 is considered developable wind resource and good wind. And so what we see is that birds predominantly fly. This is distance to those good winds. And we can tell that birds were predominantly flying closer to those good winds. What it tells us is that eagles are using similar wind resources as wind energy developers, which is suggested there is real potential for conflict. So flight altitude is linked to the landform over which birds fly. It's correlated to the type of flight behavior, and eagles are using the same resources that developers. So all of this highlights the value of understanding flight behavior to risk management. So that's sort of part one, and I'm going to try and speed up so I can get through the other parts without having you all run for the exits. the second quick part is on flight speed and flight preference. I talked about these satellite telemetry units and the GSM units that we're using. The two tracks up here are tracks from eagles that were measured at 1 hour intervals, and the lines between them are, we're just sort of pulling those out of the air. We're just drawing the straightest line between two data points. We don't know if this eagle went like this and down to there, and this one went down there, not to that point. All we know is that they were here then, and 1 hour later they were there. Same thing for these. These are the GSM units where we're getting 30 second data. We know exactly where those birds went. We have a lot of information on how they flew. And so we get all kinds of crazy information. This is two different birds on two different days going down the same ridge line. You can see they're both responding the same way. That's really good because it means we can model risk. There's consistency in eagle behavior. We've seen a lot more evidence of this in the data, which shows it graphically. This is a bird thermaling. Came in from this side, felt a little bit of lift right here, turned around, got a whole pile of lift, came out of the thermal, didn't like the lift it had, so went back into the thermal, got lift, and glided out of there. These are really difficult data to get with any other system except for ours. You would have to watch this eagle travel over hundreds of miles, and we can get it just sitting there. Well, once you trap the bird, then it's easy to get this stuff.
Is that a migratory pattern or a local pattern that we're looking at?
This particular one was a bird that we tracked. Do you know Pennsylvania at all? There's an area in State College where there's no longer a Paterno statue. It's right on a ridge called Bald Eagle Ridge. South of that is a town called Altoona. This bird was basically moving. We released it about halfway between State College and Altoona, and it was migrating south. I would categorize this particular movement. This was probably somewhere in the gray zone, because this bird probably moved 5 to 10 kilometers that day. But this was actually a low altitude thermal. You know, this was bird was probably a maximum of 200 meters above the ground. So you know, it was a little thermal on the ridge, basically. One of the things that they did was, in the previous stuff, I was simplifying things a little bit because they often mix up the two types of flight. They'll thermal and then they'll hit a ridge and then they'll switch back and forth. But you've got to simplify to understand sometimes.
Is there a wind farm by State College?
There are several.
There's the Penn State and Lehigh did, yeah. As this, you know, the engineering?
There's several. There's the biggest one is actually one ridge to the west on something called Ice Mountain, and we've actually had like half of our 200 eagles go right through Ice Mountain, and they've got a pile of wind turbines on that ridge. But yeah, there are, Pennsylvania is one of the main spots in eastern North America for development wind energy, and it's also a really important spot for rapid migration, which is why we have money to study this issue there. Feel free to ask questions if there are more. It'll slow me down a bit, but okay.
Probably stupid questions, it must be a very good answer. Is there a way to turn the wind turbines off during migration?
There are, but it's not easy. There's a couple of reasons. There's something called feathering where they can turn them down, operationally shut them down. There's a whole area called operational mitigation. You can do, if you want to reduce risk, you can sight the turbines better, and most of our work is focused on placing and sighting these turbines. But you can also feather, turn them off at certain times or change their operational strategy, and that's operational mitigation. The problem is, there are two issues. First of all, if the turbine's not spinning, then the energy developer and operator is, in the way our economics work, losing money because they're not making money. Where they're certainly not making money. But the other problem is that the gearboxes that run these things are not really well suited to frequent on and off. You know, this is a new technology. I would not be surprised if in 20 years they're much better at it. But they don't like to turn on and off because it reduces the lifespan.
The way they lubricate.
Yeah.
The way the engines, they're self-lubricating,
yeah.
So that if you turn them on and off, you're much higher to have a motor failure.
Right.
Because those kind of engines, we use them in refrigeration too. You need to keep them, the better they run, the better they lubricate.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense. And so that's the big issue. The one thing that has been done, and this has been really well done for bats, it turns out that bat risk to bats Eastern North America is primarily in the month of August, under low wind speeds. And so there was a really nice study done where these folks went and they figured out that most of the mortality, the speed at which the turbine started turning was something like 3 meters per second of wind. And they found out that if they started the turbine spinning at 4 meters per second of wind, instead of 3, they just waited until slightly stronger winds. They reduced back fatalities by something like 50 to 80%, and they reduced power, they reduced profit by less than 1%. So it had a, it was almost a win-win. They had a big win for the bats and at very low cost to the developers, at a cost that was acceptable within their business model. And so that's an example of operational mitigation that worked. There's not a lot, but yeah.
Yeah, a question about the wind turbines and the size and the rotational speed. The small, the older ones have a faster speed, and,
yep.
And the large ones, it's a big, slow sweep. Does that have, is there a difference in effect there?
So at Altamont, the answer is not really clear in my mind. At Altamont, they've done what they call repowering, where they've replaced a lot of these small turbines with newer ones. One thing to bear in mind is a big turbine that looks like it's spinning slowly, if the blade is 150 feet long, the tip speeds are 200 miles an hour. Even though it's making 16 revolutions a minute, 14 to 16 revolutions a minute, which is, you know, from our eye, from a quarter mile away, that looks pretty slow. And the inside of that blade is not going, it's not covering a lot of distance, but the outside is covering a huge area, and so it's going to 180, 200 miles an hour. But they have seen some impacts with repowering for certain species, with changing from small turbines to big turbines. But I think a big impact of it is if you go to Tehachapi and Altamont and you look at the old turbines, they're placed really close together, and so you get this wall of turbines, which is really tough for a bird to navigate. The bigger turbines, because of the aerodynamics and the impact on wind, they have to space them much further apart, and that in and of itself may be having a big difference. But I think that the jury is still out on some of that stuff. There's all types of conflicting information, and I'm not sure what's right. I'm not sure that it's been really decided yet. So you expect animals to maximize their flight speed, minimize their energetic expenditure, right? You know, if you've got a car, you want to get from point A to point B, use as little gas as possible, but get there as quickly as possible. That's the basic concept. And so I mentioned that they use this subsidized lift, soaring and gliding in thermals and using this deflected ridge lift. And we've always assumed that riding these ridges is faster, because if you think about it, when you get on the Kittatinny Ridge, which goes by Hawk Mountain, you can get on the Kittatinny, southern Pennsylvania, Maryland, something like that, and you can go north, actually they would be coming south of the Kittatinny. So you get on it in northern Pennsylvania, you hit that ridge, you just go in a straight line, going south, and you don't ever stop. Whereas if you're in a thermal, you go up, you're going in circles, right? Not going in a straight line, and you come out of that thermal in a straight line, but then you've got to search and find another thermal, and go up. So that's an interruptive flight. It doesn't seem like it would be very efficient. But nobody really knew this, right? And so we decided to test this using this high-frequency telemetry. And what we can do is, if you look at the data, you can actually get a sense for what flight mode the birds are using. So here's a whole series of data points really close together, and they're drifting in one direction, and that is a bird in a thermal, all right? It's going, sort of turning fairly tightly, and what you're seeing is it turns, and each of these data points that are more or less in a line, they're drifting a little bit, you're getting the bird in sort of, it's got a period of about 30 seconds to these circles it's making. And so you're getting that, and then it's really high, and then, here it comes out of that thermal, and it's going faster. The data points are further apart, right? And it's losing altitude. So here's a thermal. You can see in this place, this is flight altitude. The altitude is increasing slightly.
that's these triangles. Here's why that the bird was doing, the data points are further apart, and he's losing altitude the whole time, all right? And then here is what's called this slope soaring, this using a ridge, the deflected air currents. You can see it's riding the topography right up there. It's going right along the ridge, and its altitude, its flight altitude, is relatively constant. So this is, we went in and we classified five birds manually, actually not me, one of the people who works with me, went in and classified all of these flight behaviors by hand, which is not easy, but it's really cool, because we know this bird was riding the ridge. We know the combination of the data points spaced far apart and the loss of altitude and the lack of topographic features following it means that it was gliding out of thermal. Here was where it's gaining altitude again, that thermal, those triangles, which we don't have a map of that one, but it's going to be increasing in those triangles as well. We can identify what these birds are doing. And then we could look at ground speed of these birds as they're moving north. And so we can test this hypothesis, which one's faster. So it turns out that when a bird is in a thermal and it's soaring, it's gaining altitude in that thermal, it's going at about 10 meters per second. When it's slope soaring, riding the ridge, it's going at about 11 meters per second. So not a whole lot different than riding a thermal. When it's gliding, it's coming out of that thermal, it's gotten a whole ton of altitude, it's cruising down, it's going at 18 meters per second. So it's going a lot faster. And it turns out, when they're gliding and soaring, if you average these two, gliding and thermal soaring, it's actually faster than slope soaring. Right? And there are a couple different ways to measure this, because you can measure it over the total length of the day, or you can measure it by the actual behavior they're in. Doesn't matter. Gliding and soaring is faster than slope soaring. So our prediction was completely wrong. We thought it was going to be faster to just ride a ridge, but it turns out it's actually faster to get up real high, even if you're going in circles and then gain all kinds of speed going down. Yeah.
Might it take less energy to ride the ridge?
No, it's about the same. I mean, their wings are fixed, and all they're doing is using their tail to rudder a little bit, slotting their prime.
So, I mean, that seems easier than having to soar and glide. No?
It's the same thing. Yeah, they don't flap any of the time, in either behavior. It's all subsidized. Okay, yeah. There's somebody, a guy named Ofer Bahat in Israel did something with a griffon vulture in Israel where he put a heart rate monitor on this bird to try to understand metabolic expenditure when the bird was flying. Basically, when a griffon vulture has its wings locked and it's soaring, it's actually using less energy than when it's perched. And so that doesn't matter if it's riding a ridge or whatever, as long as its wings are locked, they're just relaxed. This is the way their wings need to be. And an eagle probably is not as efficient as a griffon vulture, but they're pretty close. They're big soaring birds, yeah.
How fast do they go when they're flapping? And they're using their wings?
They're probably almost certainly not going to go 18 meters per second. They're probably going to be somewhere around 10 to 15 meters per second. Turns out, it's good timing. I have a book called Avian Flight that I've been reading, and I'm getting into it because that's what makes me happy. But it turns out that the weight of a bird and the maximum speed at which it flies are not highly correlated, and generally maximum speeds for birds are between 10 and 20 meters per second, regardless of
how big or small they are.
Yeah, and that's primarily for flapping flight, but you know, you can see even gliding. You know, peregrine falcons, after a long stoop, are probably going faster than that. But, you know, it's still, there's probably, I'm not smart enough about physics to know the reality here, but there's probably physical constraints that have to do with gravity and air resistance and things like that. They just max things out. So, anyway, so thermaling and gliding is faster than slope soaring. Turns out when they're gliding out of the thermal, they can go the direction they really want to go. And if you know the ridges of the Appalachians, they're kind of curved to the east, especially in Pennsylvania. They start over, you know, central PA, and they sort of curve towards Scranton and Wilkes-Barre and Bethlehem. And an eagle really wants to go north, not northeast. So slope sorting takes it off track. So that's the other side of this equation. It turns out that if you're riding a ridge, it's not as straight as it needs to be, and that costs them some. So whenever possible, eagles are going to be using a thermal. That's actually good, because if you think back, thermals put birds higher in the air, which means less potential risk. But this whole question of flight mode has implications to risk. So we also looked at the impact of weather on these birds. Again, we expect animals to maximize flight speed and minimize energetic expenditure. We already said that. And we expect flight behavior to change in response to weather. And what we did here is we compared change in altitude, so change in flight altitude, to wind speed and altitude itself. And again, this was using this GPS GSM telemetry. What we saw on this axis, you've got height band, which is a measure of the change in altitude of the bird over a certain period of time. So it's basically the maximum minus the minimum flight altitude. So when wind speed is low, there's a whole range of flight of variabilities in flight altitude. So what it means is some of the time birds are not changing altitude at all, some of the time they're changing altitude a lot. When wind speeds are, and when, I'll get to an explanation of this in a sec. When wind speeds are high, they're not changing altitude a lot at all. They're staying fairly constant in altitude. There's nothing going on up here. No high height bands, no variability in flight altitude. So what's going on with this? Almost certainly what's going on is that at low wind speeds, birds are riding thermals, right? You can get a thermal developing. Now when the wind picks up, what happens to a thermal? A thermal is sort of an ephemeral thing, right? It's just a column of air. When wind kicks up, the wind's going to come along and break that thermal down. It's going to destroy that thermal. And so an eagle can't ride a thermal in high wind because there aren't any thermals in high wind. So they've got to ride ridges in high wind. And so when you ride a ridge, your altitude stays fairly constant. You don't go up and down in altitude a lot. Whereas when you're in a thermal, you go up, you go down, you go up, you go down. And so this is a response to weather conditions. Again, if you think about it, that should have implications for wind energy, if we can understand the type of weather that is going to push birds to ridges, and thus the type of bird weather that's going to increase risk to birds if the turbines are on the ridges. This is average height band and average altitude above ground level were also correlated. It's basically more of the same thing. The more that there's change in altitude, more that the birds are higher in altitude on average. So again, that means they're using thermals, they're going up and down, but on average their flight altitude is higher, whereas if their altitude is lower, they're not changing altitude a lot, they're staying lower. This just corresponds to exactly what I was saying a moment ago. So as wind speed increases, eagles fly lower. As they fly lower, they change altitude less. And this informs us to the type of flight behavior in different weather. They're going to be thermaling in low wind conditions, and they're going to be slope soaring in high wind conditions. So that's basically the data analysis that we've been doing. The next step is modeling to understand the risk of birds to development of wind energy. There have been impacts we know in other places. This is a picture I took in Norway. These are two white-tailed sea eagles. This is an island called Smyrla. Smyrla used to have the highest breeding density of white-tailed sea eagles anywhere in the world. And now it doesn't because they put up wind turbines. I stood in an eagle's nest that was literally 30 yards from the base of one of these turbines. And so one of the things we find consistently with turbines is that there are good places to put turbines and there are bad places to put turbines. Altamont, bad. Smyrla, very bad. But, you know, Pennsylvania, Eastern North America, we don't know of any mortality of eagles
yet in these areas. There are not huge numbers of turbines yet. I think that if we put turbines in the wrong places, we're going to see mortality here in the east. But as of yet, we've been fairly lucky in mortality that's been fairly low. Yeah.
Is that a function of the open nature of the land, both at Altamont and Norway?
I think, well, yes and no. I mean, generally, eagles are in open country. I mean, when they come through, eastern North America is a little bit of an oddity in terms of these, in terms of birds. But most people think of eagles as open country birds. Wyoming has tons of open country. California does as well. What really happens, Altamont is bad because it's a hunting area for these birds. They're focused on something else rather than the turbines. They're focused on the prey. There's lots of ground squirrels there. Smyrna is bad because it's a nesting area with lots of young, dumb juveniles flying around that don't understand what's going on. So a huge portion of their mortality is juveniles. I think that, you know, when you have this many eagles and this many turbines, you're bound to have collisions. They're going, because it's home range, they're going in circles. And so they're repeatedly going near a turbine. So eventually they're going to get whacked. Whereas if you're migrating, you go by the turbine once, you don't go by it 20 times in a week. Is there another question?
So who is providing the financial support for the kind of research that shows the relationship?
For the work that we're doing?
Yeah.
We get money from all over the place. In eastern North America, I have money from a couple of states, Virginia and Pennsylvania especially. Generally, those are federal funds that get routed to the states for use in conservation projects, SWIG money, state wildlife grant money. I have money from the U.S. Department of Energy for this work in the east, and then I have money from Bureau of Land Management and the State of California for work in California. And then I have private donors. And so I have just, I mean, nowadays, if you want to do this stuff, you've got to have lots of different sources.
But you're not getting stuff from the wind turbine people?
Not
to understand the location?
Not yet. We have just built a few relationships with some of these folks. And they are doing it. In business, you don't do things out of the goodness of your heart. You do it because it's your business model. And in this case, they are under, the wind companies are under a lot of pressure from the permitting agencies, which are fed from the state, to show either that there is no impact to eagles or that the impact to eagles is being mitigated or doing or taking steps. And so, you know, a couple of cases in California where you've been essentially contracted to provide analyses. These contracts let me fund money into my staff available and working and things like that. But that is something that's small, but I would hope it will continue to grow. Nothing in the east yet. I've talked to a couple of people. Yeah.
Eagles don't run into trees or stationary buildings, and they don't run into other eagles and birds that are moving.
Yep.
So why can't they figure out the turbines? They're just too fast?
You know, I think part of it's the speed. There's a couple of things. Some birds do run into stationary buildings. You know, we all see birds bouncing off of glass.
Reflecting glass.
Yeah.
These aren't reflecting.
But these are big moving things. I mean, the best analogy that I like to give is when I walk up to a street, I know there's cars coming left and right, and so does everybody in this room, but there's probably somebody in this room who's been hit by a car because we weren't paying attention, you know? And people get hit by cars all the time, and we're a lot smarter than the eagles. We know exactly what that car is coming and why it's coming. Eagles just don't understand that if this blade is right here, right now, it's going to be over here. So, you know, there's nothing in their nature that's involved them to understand that. Having said that, the most important thing seems to be the bird's behavior at a specific time. So Altamont is a big problem because they hunt there. When you're hunting, you're not looking in front of you, you're looking down.
Distracted by them.
And there, yeah, it is exactly that. So we, there was a recent paper that was published where somebody followed a griffin vulture in a glider, and they basically measured the amount of time the bird was looking down or ahead. And, you know, griffin vultures are foraging by looking down for prey. They're usually a lot higher than a turbine, but they spent like 80% of their time looking directly down, which helps you understand it too. I think Smyrla is different because it's just such a high density and they're all going in circles, but it's pretty clear that at Altamont, the big problem is the birds are hunting, they're not there, and so they're distracted. So, yeah.
How are the units powered? Is it solar? I mean,
basically these units are a cell phone, and the units that my company makes. It's a cell phone, but it's stripped down to the real basic components. But they've got a lithium battery in there, a lithium ion battery usually, and they've got a solar panel on the back. And so they recharge on a regular basis. If that solar panel gets covered by feathers, deposed, you know, and or even partially covered because of the way it works. But it is something that it's pretty cool. They work for a couple of years, and our longest running one so far has been working for 3 years now. And it's starting to flake out. The battery power is doing some weird stuff, but it's still cranking. So this is all more about the modeling, and I have a huge amount of collaborators and co-authors and everything else. You had asked about funding. Pennsylvania Game Commission, Department of Energy, West Virginia DNR, Virginia Department of Game and Inland Fisheries, BLM, and Ministry of Natural Resources in Quebec, and a whole suite of private donors as well. Dave Branch at Lafayette, Jeff Cooper's in Virginia, half of these people are on I employ, and some of them are from up north. Phil Turks, our statistician, who's really smart. But this is a group effort. You can't do this type of thing without other people. That is the main body of the talk, and I've gone over what I feel like is my allotted time. I have a few more pretty pictures. If people are enthusiastic, I can show them. They're welcome to bug out if I'm putting you to sleep, and I won't take it personally. Actually, this is a good thing. I like talking about this stuff because what I want to do next doesn't involve telemetry, but it does involve these trail cameras and monitoring birds and where. We know this population of eagles is small and poorly understood. We know that they were extirpated largely from eastern North America. We know eastern U.S. We know they migrate through our area. We know they winter here. But we don't know how many there are. We don't know anything about what they do. And so I put together a program to collect images of these birds to try to understand their distribution density during winter. And I've actually got this webpage, appalachianeagles.org, which has hundreds of pictures of golden eagles on there. And I'm twisting Lori's arm to get her to run a bait station so she can contribute pictures to this as well. Basically what we do is we take a cinder block and a 4x4 and a motion sensitive trail camera, and we find a small opening in the woods. This is actually about the biggest opening we've ever used, but it's good for pictures. And we drop some roadkill deer about 10 feet in front of it, and we just go away. And you've got to have batteries in this thing and everything else. But these are trail cameras. They're really big things these days. Some of you have probably used them. You can get them for under $100. I have bought probably about 150 of them now because I'm so geared up about this. And what happens is you get pictures of everything that comes in. So this is three golden eagles at a bait site. This camera was way too far away. We since modified the protocols, but you can get a sense. You know, you can get three birds at once on occasion. You also get lots of other stuff coming in. One of the things you can do is
is identify individuals if you're careful about it. So this is an adult golden eagle. This is the first year golden eagle, and when you put them side by side, you can see there's differences in feather patterns. You know, it doesn't take an experienced eye to see there's some white on the coverts here, no white on the coverts there. There's a lot of white on the tail on that bird, typical of the lumber bird, not much white out there on the tail of that bird. So you can actually start to identify them, and this is a really simple way to collect lots of data on these birds. So as an example, in West Virginia, we had about, in 2011, we had about 30 bait sites in West Virginia. You can tell most of these are on the ridges. This was 2011. We've actually since expanded into western West Virginia. We've got a few golden eagles over there as well. And we've actually got bait sites out in Maryland, actually up here in Maryland, in Garrett County, and a few others up there. We had 856 camera days. So these are days in which a camera was operating. So if we had two cameras operating on day one, then that would be two camera days. The most common species reported in terms of proportion of camera days in which they were seen were American crows. Common ravens were the second most common. Golden eagles were the third most common. That does not mean that golden eagles are the third most common bird out there. It doesn't even mean the third most common scavenging bird out there. What it does mean, though, is that we are setting these traps, these camera traps, in the right place, and we're doing it in a really good way to get golden eagles. 42% of the days we had golden eagles. We had 96 camera days with two golden eagles, and we had three camera days with three golden eagles. That's just in one image. So there were many of these days where we probably had five golden eagles showing up. One would come in, and then an hour later, a different one would come in. But we're just doing frequency of occurrence of the species with this. And so, you know, if we have five separate golden eagles come in at five separate times, that would count as one golden eagle camera day. So 268 red tails, a few of the other species. We've got lots of raccoons, coyotes, bobcats, bald eagles, two bald eagles, red-shouldered hawks, gray fox, red fox, striped skunk, and spotted skunk. Do you have any records of spotted skunk in the state? Probably not. Everybody gets excited about spotted skunk because they're unusual. Before we started doing this camera trapping, people thought golden eagles were occasional winter vagrants in West Virginia. We now know they're everywhere. And West Virginia DNR would get maybe one or two records of spotted skunk per year from their fur bearer trappers. We had 24 camera days in 2011 alone. We have produced more spotted skunk records for the state than anybody had ever imagined if we were even out there. We get some really cool pictures. This is a golden eagle with a satellite transmitter. You can see the antenna fighting with another golden eagle over a deer carcass, also from West Virginia. This is a spotted skunk spraying a raccoon. they actually do stand on their front paws when they spray over their back. And we had another image of a, we didn't get the actual spraying, but we had a skunk and a raccoon together in one image, and then the next image, the raccoon is drooling, bleary-eyed, it's got its mouth open, the skunk is nowhere to be seen, and it's pretty clear what happened. So we get coyotes and bobcats living together, strange things. This is from Pennsylvania. You guys must have Fisher. I had a Fisher in my parents' backyard in Massachusetts, in Amherst. This is a young bald eagle about to nail a red tail, a very scared red tail. This is an oh shit picture. it actually turns out that the red tail survived this, the next image. The next image shows a very disheveled red tail sort of looking worriedly at a happy bald eagle. This one is a pretty dramatic example of stress. some of the behavior in some of these trail cams. This is two golden eagles. One of the things that's nice about this, you can actually age this bird. I think it's a third year or fourth year golden eagle based on molds. Because some of these feathers up here are juvenile feathers and some of them are adult feathers. And when you get a nice spread wing like that, you can age these birds fairly. I would say you can estimate the age, yeah.
How long do they live?
Good question. Golden eagles take about 5 years to reach sexual maturity. Well, they take 5 years to reach adult plumage. Often they'll breed a year or two before. Their mortality rate is highest in those first 5 years, but if they survive until they're 3 or 4 years old, then they can easily survive until 20 or 30.
It's not
uncommon. Yeah, so somebody in Maine just told me that we had a meeting, this meeting in Jasper, we had a biologist from Maine who came up there. We were talking about band recoveries. They just got a dead bald eagle with a band. And the bald eagle was one of the original balls hacked out on the Quabbin Reservoir in the 70s.
Wow.
So, yeah, I mean, that's about as long as you get a bird living. Like 35 years is not unheard of for an eagle.
The record that I know, if you mentioned Kazakhstan, where I've worked there, and you've seen so-called Barracuda eagle, which is a version of the golden, you have a picture of the interior.
Yep.
But the record that I know of there is 70-year-old bird.
Yeah,
and that's exceptional, and of course it's not living out in the wild.
Right. The birds that live the longest are some of the seabirds, petrels. And there is a guy, there was a story a year or two ago about a guy who was looking at some Caribbean petrel. And when he was in his first year on this bandit on this island, he was a 22-year-old kid, bandit, an adult female, I think, petrel. And he recaptured her 2 years ago, and he's now like a 75-year-old man. And this bird was still breeding at something like 60 years old. And there are very, very few verified records like that.
The highest altitude I've heard for an eagle, maybe you know something different, but it's 28,000 feet. Filmed by a pilot, it was a Russian steppe eagle, and it was over the border of Tibet and Nepal, there, where the Himalayas are very, very high.
It wouldn't surprise me at all. There are climbers on Everest. There are lots of good records of climbers on Everest seeing cranes migrating above them. Everest is 30,000 feet. Cranes are some of the highest altitude flyers, and they actually have specific lung systems.
And the barred-headed goose there is seen at that altitude.
Yeah. Yeah.
But for an eagle, I hear 28,000. I haven't heard higher than that.
So, you get individuals. This is at the Furneaux Experimental Forest in West Virginia. Just lots of eagles in all these pictures. So, that's the end of the pictures. I do think it would be great if we could get a bait site going. And I really appreciate your time and attention. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.